Hey, Harrison. Hey, Thaddea. How are you guys?
Oh, good. Yeah, thank you. How are you?
I'm doing well. Thank you. So I'm excited to talk to you about the Irregulars. I watched the first few episodes and I'm addicted already. So congratulations. Yeah, congratulations to you guys on that. I wanted to see your feelings on, you know, you're now part of a lore that spans, you know, a long time in this world, you know. And what does that feel like to play, you know, iconic kind of characters in literature, now screen? Mm. Harrison, did you want to go first?
Yeah, I mean, it's exciting. I mean, the Baker Street Irregulars, I think there's only sort of four or five lines in the original Arthur Conan Doyle books about the Irregulars. And our creator, Tom Bidwell, has sort of taken those five lines and make it into an 8-hour episodic extravaganza. So it's been amazing. And to be able to sort of draw from those sort of iconic characters from the Sherlock Holmes universe, who with their sort of storylines, their characters, the villains, it's been really fun to play with. And also just focusing on a story that we haven't really seen before and characters we don't really know anything about has been really exciting.
And how about for you, Thaddea?
I think it was definitely a little bit daunting to enter this such an iconic world with such an incredible fan base already. But I think it's very exciting to bring a fresh take on it. The supernatural element and a Sherlock and a Watson, that they're such iconic figures, but I think in our version, we have a representation of them that we've not really seen before. And then of course, our series focuses more on the Baker Street Irregulars and how they fit into the world. And I think Tom, like you were saying, Harrison, has created such a beautiful world for us to explore. And it's just really exciting to finally be able to share it, because we've kind of been squirreling away on it by ourselves.
It has been.
So I'm really excited to see what people think.
Yeah, I mean, I absolutely, as I said, I'm hooked already. So you got one super fan already.
Yes,
that's good. Yes, one.
And so, you know, I've never been to the UK, and I will get there at some point. But it's really cool, kind of world building, both literally and figuratively. One, in this universe that is kind of created with the series, and then also like the actual physical set, you know, the location. I feel like I'm in that era of London, which is pretty freaking cool. Is that, I mean, you know, obviously you guys are there, so it's a little bit different for you, but did you kind of get that sense of, wow, I'm like transported in time here as you're filming?
Absolutely. I remember my first day on set, I was in the Victorian costume, and we walked up into Liverpool, which is up north, and we were walking across cobbled streets, and I just felt so much like we were in that world, and it was kind of exciting. And I remember seeing our version of 221B for the first time, and I kind of got a little bit of chills, because it's such an iconic door and such an iconic place, that to see it in real life was kind of really exciting. And we had beautifully built sets. We were very fortunate in that sense. We did do some green screen work, but a lot of it was really, really there. Or we went out to these locations, and Harrison saw some beautiful places.
Yeah, I was very lucky. I mean, playing the sort of Prince of England, there's some cool locations that come with that, and Buckingham Palace and these sort of amazing stately homes. But Netflix did an amazing job. They built these sort of two Victorian streets on the back of this stately home. Filled it with sort of supporting artists. They're all doing their own thing, and obviously everyone's in costume, and you literally walk out into it and you're like, wow, I'm in 19th century London. And then you look the other way and everyone's still on their iPhones calling out cut and action. You're like, oh wait, I need to take a step back. But Netflix did an amazing job of making us sort of feel at home in that world.
Well, it's interesting that that you guys bring that up. Harrison, you know, in the first episode, not really a spoiler, you're like, you know, I just want to get out. And I'm like, I just want to go. Like, I just want to go hang out there. Like, okay.
Yeah, no, definitely.
But what I love, particularly between the two of you, is the kind of I shouldn't use big words when I don't know them.
I did start to panic there. I was like, oh no, what's
up? Oh, here comes the big one. Oh gosh, get the dictionary out.
Exactly. You're diametrically opposed. That's the word I was looking for. So like, as B, Thaddea, you know, you're kind of street smart and I don't want to say rough, but rough, where Harrison, you know, Leopold is kind of the opposite,
polished.
You know.
Polished.
There you go.
Polished,
there you go.
Is a word that I'd use, yeah. Definitely.
And I love how both of you bring, you know, as artists, as creatives, how you bring that to those characters that are so, you know, on the outside, you know, as a viewer, like opposites in many ways.
Definitely.
I think what's lovely about their connection is that it's not just like, oh, you're really fit, I fancy you. The connection comes from the intelligence and how he thinks and how B thinks and the kind of empathy and emotion. And I think that's a really lovely thing to see on screen. It's not just kind of, what's it called? Like it's not just like face. It's really about, as cheesy as it sounds, it's really about what is inside and how they think and how they help each other grow in so many ways. And I think that's really beautiful to see.
And yeah, I think it's sort of like, it starts off where, come from very different backgrounds and had a very different past as well. But and we sort of start like this, but as we get closer and figure out more about each other, we start to level off, and then it goes the other way, and it's a real sort of roller coaster. And there is so much sort of meaty material for B and Leo to sort of explore that relationship as the series goes on. And it's been a fun ride.
There's a really beautiful line that I think B is talking to Leo quite early on, maybe episode 2. And she says, like, where will you be sleeping tonight? Because I'll be sleeping in a cellar. And that's not your fault. You are who you are. And I love that she kind of encourages him not to be apologetic for where he comes from. And the same for her. She doesn't need to apologize for the way that she's been brought up or who she is. It's just, that's how life's made us. That's okay. And you don't need to change that. I like you. I like your qualities and your personality and how you think. And I think that's a really beautiful line.
It is. And, you know, it's very representative of one of the themes in the show, which is, you know, take me as I am. I can't change where I was born. I can't change the circumstances that I've been dealt. I can only, you know, do what I can do within those circumstances to overcome them or try to get outside of them or whatever. But I think it's a really beautiful theme in the series that that I've seen so far that I think is really special.
Yeah, definitely. I think we see it as well with Jessie, played by Darcy. And she sees this kind of her visions and these nightmares that she's having at the very start as a weakness and as something really to be feared. But that is just something that's part of her. And as the series goes on, she realizes, actually, this is a power. And she shifts it into something positive and something that she harnesses. And I think that's really lovely to see. And I think all of the characters start to look at their weaknesses and transform them into something that they actually can use. And I think that's quite empowering for people to see.
And I've just adding on to that, like, I feel like the Irregulars aren't your regular heroes at all. I mean, we've all got, like our sort of insecurities and flaws and what we see as weaknesses. But when we're all put together, we complement each other's characters. And it's a really amazing thing to see, to like when we all come together in camaraderie as a team, that's when we work best.
Yeah, we keep saying that, you know, any one of them, if one of them were to walk away, it wouldn't work well. It's a team effort. And I think as a human race, maybe we should look at working together a little bit more.
That would be good.
Yeah, absolutely. So one of my favorite shows ever, definitely my favorite show ever, is called The X-Files, and it's been off forever and then came back. And one of the things that I loved about that is the mythology that they built over the series. And then they also had what fans called Monster of the Week episodes. And one of the things that I really enjoy about the Irregulars is it kind of has not the same sort of vibe as the X-Files, but it has that longer arching mythology and world building and character developments and such. But then it also has something interesting and sometimes terrifying each week. Does that make it, you know, easier, more interesting for you as creatives?
It's less of a monster of the week and monster of the episode. I mean, monster of the day. Every day when we were filming, there seemed to be a new monster or a new villain popping up, and it definitely keeps you interested and really engaged, because it's quite a compelling story, and finding out the backstory of these villains and these monsters and where they've come from and why they've sort of taken the darker path. As I said, yeah, Tom created a great world where you can dive into these sort of villain psyches and see where they started out and the kind of person they were before that.
Mm. I think also what you're saying about the mythology around the X-Files, I think Tom has done brilliantly in creating this underlying theme of grief and how these villains have been driven to this point because of loss and because of grief and because maybe they haven't dealt with it in a healthy manner. And that's what they're searching to connect with, that loss. And so although they are villains and they're monsters, it's not your typical like bogeyman under the bed.
No.
It's very real people who are just suffering a massive loss. And so that, I suppose, is our mythology. And that's what and connects
makes,
all of them.
Makes it scarier as well.
Yeah,
I think,
absolutely.
Because it comes with it very authentic and grounded, and you can see where it can come from. Which is, but also, yeah, with the supernatural element, it's a really fun thing to play. And then when you can add all these incredible visual effects to it, it comes up with something special.
Yeah, right in the first episode, I was like, and again, I don't want to spoil, but, you know, one of the irregulars has a problem seeing. And you know, I saw this scene and I'm like, oh, wow. Like, this is where we're going here. You know,
yeah.
I wasn't expecting that. I mean, I kind of expected, obviously, like a supernatural element. But when I saw the scene and I was just like, oh, OK, we're showing the whole thing here.
Yeah. It's
that,
dark.
That really threw me there. I was like, problem seeing, who wears glasses? Like,
yeah. There's a very sort of
you're right. We had very visceral image. And I think our department who did that, the hair and makeup department, Lucy Civic, was our designer on that, and she is just a prosthetic god. And the entire team worked together to make that actually physically real on set, and then it was heightened with VFX. But even just, you know, walking around and seeing these really, really awful things in real life is very, very jarring, because you know it's not real, but you just don't expect to see it.
No. Especially at 5 a.m. on the morning on a Monday. It's quite a scary image to walk on set to. Oh my God, I'm awake now.
Stronger than coffee.
Yeah, I would say. So you guys did have a bit of a troubled production, you know, particularly with COVID and all that. What was that like, you know, to be working on a series like this and then and have this bump in the road?
Mm. I think we were very fortunate that we had spent so long together before we had to shut down. We'd spent maybe 6-7 months together. So the entire team, like the crew and the cast, all felt like family. So when we did come back, I think everyone was a little bit apprehensive. It's the kind of the fear of the unknown, I suppose. So we were all talking together going, oh, I feel a bit nervous. Do you feel a bit nervous? Okay, you feel nervous too. That's fine. We're all feeling the same kind of apprehension. But we went back and they had incredible COVID protocols, because we were one of the first UK productions to start up again. So they put in so many safety measures, and we were getting tested all the time. They were fogging the sets, social distancing, isolation. And it actually felt so, so safe. I think that was probably one of the safest places we could be, because everyone was being so vigilant. And we had 2 weeks to wrap, 2 weeks away from wrap when we shut down, and then we extended that to 4. So we doubled our time so that we could really do it safely. And I think everyone really appreciated that.
Yeah, and I think as well, because originally, yeah, the original email that went out on the weekend was that, oh, we're just going to take 3 days hiatus, guys. Probably nothing. I wouldn't worry about it. And then obviously 5 months later, we end up going back to filming. And as Thaddea said, the protocols were incredible, and it probably was the safest place you could be. But it was also quite nice as well, because we've been filming for so long in those 8 months, and the last two episodes are a real sort of epic finale and a really sort of a big climactic point. So to come back with that sort of renewed energy and renewed sort of found thing to want to finish this right and finish it with as much energy and positivity as possible was really important. And I think we achieved that. So yeah, it's good.
And what about, you know, the future of the Irregulars? Can we, you know, there's an eight episode series at this point. Can we look forward to more adventures with the Irregulars?
I really hope so.
Yeah.
We haven't heard anything yet about season two, but I think everyone is just chomping at the bit to get back, and we'd go back with a heart and a half. The entire team and that were just a dream to work with. And I think Tom Bidwell has created such a world that is just so expansive, and there's so much more to explore. Stories have kind of tied up a little bit, but there's still room for more mystery and more adventure. And I would love to go back. I think we all would.
Definitely, yeah. And like, even though this sort of, it's amazing, this story that goes sort of full circle and it's bringing back characters from earlier episodes, and but it does also leave it sort of a bit open-ended as well, which is exciting. And yeah, I mean, we hope we can do it again. And but mainly we just hope that sort of audiences can sort of connect with it and empathize with the characters and then hopefully get behind it and want to see more.
Yeah, I know, like I said, I'm already hooked, and I think audiences are really going to love this. And you guys have done such great works in, you know, with your roles. What is your favorite, you know, and this is obviously individually, what is your favorite part of the character for both of you?
I think for me, the journey of Leo is really something, was a real treat, because at the beginning, he's very much wrapped in sort of cotton wool, and he's never sort of had any friends outside of the palace, or never really experienced love or friendship or anything like that. And as the episodes go on, he starts to find his feet, and he's also got these illnesses that sort of have been, his staff have defined him from that. And to be able to sort of find his feet and stand up to people that have put him down his whole life has been a real fun thing to do. And by the end, he's a full-blown irregular, I think, anyway.
You and think? How about for you, Thaddea?
I think.
I think, yeah, not to copy, but I think it is the journey of kind of, especially Bea's realization that she doesn't have to do everything alone. I think she knows that she's got people around her, but it's like that thing where people say, you're not alone. And they can tell you, and you go, yeah, I hear you. But until you have that realization for yourself and really start to harness that power, I think that's a monumental thing for her to realize that, okay, I can trust other people, I can let people in, and maybe the world won't end. It might come close to it, especially in our world, but you know, there's a power in letting people in and being vulnerable.
Scary being vulnerable, but
terrifying. Yeah,
it's terrifying.
I think, you know, like those things that are really scary means that there's something at stake, and that it's worth doing,
worth exploring.
Absolutely. And you know, now that I think about it in this context, I mean, being vulnerable is as scary, if not more scary, than some of the monsters, you know, the villains that we see, because we open ourselves up. And what's scarier than that, than allowing somebody full access to judge you or whatever? Terrifying.
Yeah, scary
now
stuff.
Now I have to go to therapy.
Yeah.
Well, Harrison, Thaddea, thank you guys so much. I love the Irregulars. I can't wait for everybody to see it and love it as much as I do. And I have a feeling I'll be talking to both of you for season two.
Thank you very much, man.
Thank
nice
you
to meet
so
you.
So much.
Nice meeting you guys.
Nice to meet you. Bye.
See you. Later. See you.